Thanks very much for the invitation. I'm going to talk to you about some work that we've probably been doing now for about 4 years. And it involves using lights to modify cellular function. And if some of you are thinking, well, we haven't heard very much about that, we heard about it 3 or 4 years ago, it has progressed quite a lot. It's just that you probably may not be aware of it. I want to sort of basically put this into cartoons so you can all grab what interests me and why it might be relevant to you. Now, the thing that grabs me and what interests me is a little battery that you have in your cell. I mean, you have lots of these batteries in the cell. And they're called mitochondria. And the mitochondria, they're called the molecular unit of currency. They are basically what does all the housekeeping in your cell. It keeps your cell going. It keeps your cell functional. And they use something called ATP. You can think of the ATP basically as the electricity. So these mitochondria that we can see down here are actually exactly like a battery. So if you look at the battery underneath, there's a charge between the different sides of the battery. Well, there's also a charge across the membrane of this mitochondria, and it runs that charge up and down depending on what you need to do. Okay, so every cell has got them, but the interesting thing is your retina has got more of them than anywhere else in your body. So your retina is really peculiar because it uses more energy than any other cell in your body, more than your heart, more than your muscle. It's got an enormous energy demand. So for those of you who may have heard me when I spoke before and I was talking mainly about vitamin D, one of the things that we have got a problem with is our life expectancy. We're living quite a long time. Mitochondria, unfortunately, have got a clock that's ticking. And the clock that's ticking leads to the battery running down. So as we age, the battery runs down. And batteries do something quite interesting when they run down. They lose their charge, but then also you find you get nasty deposits on them, and they get acidic deposits around the outside. You can say they leak acid. Well, our mitochondria do that as well as we get old. So the mitochondria, it's got a picture on it there with the blue lines going around it. As it starts to leak acid, it leaks something called a reactive oxygen species, and we call those ROS. And ROS drive inflammation. And that causes damage to the DNA in a mitochondria, and then the mitochondrial function become dysfunctional, spins back on itself, the whole situation gets worse. And this is called the mitochondrial theory of aging. It's one of the fundamental theories of aging. And the problem that we have with the eye is the eye ages at a faster rate than most of the other organs in our body. So normally, as we age, by the time we've reached 70, we've lost a third of our photoreceptors in our central retina, just through age. They burn out. So what we find is as our mitochondria become dysfunctional, we get an increase in inflammation, and we get a decrease in available cellular energy, which is the ATP. And that kind of situation is the situation that interests me. Inflammation in the retina, what drives it, and how can we interfere with it? So one of the key principles I want to get over, and it's a principle that people very often forget, is the fact that everything in our environment interacts with light. Here's two basic key principles. If you go to Waitrose and buy an expensive bottle of olive oil and you leave it on your windowsill in daylight, by the time you go back in 3 or 4 weeks' time, it's not going to taste very good. Light interacts with the oil and it changes its molecular composition, it changes its taste. This is happening all around us. So actually a leaf actually looks green. It looks green because when white light is put onto it, it absorbs the red and uses that for metabolic energy, and basically it reflects the green because it doesn't want it. So all of us, in some way or other, are reflecting, we're interacting with light. So this is where I try and put it back together. Mitochondria also interact with light. Everything will absorb at certain wavelengths and reflect at certain wavelengths. Now, for some reason that we have absolutely no idea about, mitochondria, something in mitochondria, absorbs deep red light. It absorbs it at 670 nanometers and 810 nanometers. You can barely see 810. It's very, very dim because it's so far red shifted. But there's a consequence of this. As they absorb this energy, the battery starts to recharge. Okay, so as the battery starts to recharge, we produce more ATP. As we produce more ATP, we can reduce the reactive oxygen species that are driving inflammation. So we've got a whole series of graphs here. I don't want to explain them all to you. But let's put it this way. This is the retina of an aged, stressed mouse. And this mouse here has been given red light 1 minute, I think every other day for 4 days. He's been rested, and then we've processed the tissue. If you look at, so these are different markers of inflammation, and some of them are markers of inflammation that people are looking at in you, and we find that in each case, the red is reduced. So the red light in each of these pairs of graphs is reduced, and these are two identical mice, but in each case, one has been treated with red light and one has not. So what we have here is we have a light that influences mitochondria, influences mitochondrial function, and one of the consequences is it's taking down inflammation in the eye. Now, it does this in old eyes. It does this in eyes that are models of macular degeneration, and I'd love to say that it also does it in eyes that are models of birdshot, but we spent ages trying to find that model of birdshot, and unfortunately, it's long since gone and can't be regenerated very easily. So, recharging the battery. We use red light for it. In all animal studies that different labs have done, it takes about a minute. It's a relatively short exposure. If you sit there and you think 1 minute's good, an hour's going to be fantastic, well, if you sit there for an hour, actually it doesn't work as well. So, you know, it's that old principle, I'll take 15 aspirin because it's better, going to be better for me. It doesn't work. So it's a brief exposure. It must be a specific wavelength. The one that we play with is 670, and the reason for that is I can see it. I can't see 700 very well, so if I'm exposing all my mice and I'm sticking my head around the door and I want to know if the light devices are working, because they tend to chew through the cables, I can see 670, and I can't see deeper red light. Okay, so, does it work, and what's new about it? Well, there are now at least 50 labs in the world that are working. So there are at least 50 publications out there now which are actually showing from different labs this works. And it works in different systems whenever your mitochondria get compromised. And they get compromised in lots of disease processes, either directly or indirectly. So it is popular. Why are you not seeing it? You're not seeing it because when we talk to one another, our labs, we're not sharing the same words in the titles of our papers. Some people say near infrared light. Some people say 670. Some people say red light. It's a nightmare to dig it all out. And then some people are working on kidney function, and some people are working on the eye. So it sits there under the surface. We don't appreciate how much of it there is out there. But there have been some key things that are coming out which are very, very dramatic. Mitochondria suffer very, very badly at the start of Parkinson's disease. The little nucleus in your brain, the substantia nigra, the mitochondria in that nucleus suffer and you start to have movement problems. Fantastic study, which is actually just about to come out in Annals of Neurology, a very conservative, old guard sort of journal, actually showing that when monkeys have a small fiber optic inject put into their brain and shines light on the substantia nigra, when you induce the disease, it barely happens. Publication study recently in the British Journal of Ophthalmology showing that red light at 670 nanometers reduces the effects of diabetic retinopathy. Again, it's working on the fact that there are aspects of diabetes that do play upon mitochondrial function. For us progressing forward, we've now got ethical approval to use red light in old subjects, and that's something that is starting very shortly. In fact, we've started to run a few of them already. I'm one of those people, I've been exposed to the red light and had my EIG done very regularly over a period of months, and you've got my sympathy. Having that gold foil put in your eye on a regular basis and being dilated is miserable. But there are changes in my eye, and the changes in my eye we would generally describe as rather positive. My implicit times, for some of you who know them, are actually now appear to be significantly shorter than they were when I started this in July. It is gaining traction. The whole thing is gaining traction. We found out this week that we just got just over 500,000 from the Biological and Biotechnological Research Council specifically to fund this type of project to look at inflammation in the eye. And we've also had money from Innovate UK, where they're interested in how you use this method to actually produce a particular device. And of course, we've had support from you as well. And I'm extremely grateful to you for your input financially, from talking to you, and generally having you around to challenge me when you think I'm not working quickly enough. Thank you.